بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. إن شاء الله today we will complete the third block of our pediatric mechanical ventilation course. We will know how to adjust our setting according to the lung pathophysiology and lung mechanics. We will match the setting according to the disease, and this is what is called the disease-specific strategies. The disease-specific strategy is the target of our course to reach this point. So I need you to participate, to interact, to share with me, and you are the one who will give me the appropriate setting for every lung pathology according to your understanding to the lung pathophysiology and the lung mechanics and the ventilatory setting, inshallah. First of all, I want to see that the pediatric ventilation in the pediatric ICU is a big challenge. Any doctor work in the BICU know that the pediatric ventilation is very challenging for any doctor. It is a big difficult how to deal with this patient, because in the BICU, in the pediatric age group, we have a different and heterogeneous lung diseases. Each disease needing a specific strategy to be fit with this pathology and with this disease. In addition, we have a tremendous variation in the both patient age group and the patient size. We are dealing with different age group. We are dealing with the infant, with the patient in infancy, toddlers, preschool children, school children, even the teenager and the adolescent patient. We can deal with all these age group. So there is heterogeneous, there is different size, there is different age, different physiological parameters for each patient, for each age group. At the same time, in your BICU, you can admit one infant 2 or 3 months with 4 or 5 kilogram, and you need to ventilate this lung. At the same time, you can admit another adolescent 12 or 14 years old, and you need to ventilate this lung. So there is big difference between two age groups, even between the physiological parameters for each patient. So our practice in the BICU to some extent looks like heterogeneous. There is no agreement on the specific protocols in the BICU, like the adult ICU or the neonatal ICU. There is no agreement. We have a little evidence-based and little data supporting any of the ventilator strategies we are using in the BICU. Why I said this? Because you will find a lot of protocols, a lot of practice. We are depending mainly in the our strategies in the practice, in the opinion of the expertise, not on the good evidence base or something like this. We are at some times extract our evidence from the adult ICU or even from the neonatal ICU to match with our patient or our diseases. So don't worry. Please keep all the time adherent to the basics of the lung ventilation. Try all the time not to do harm for your patient. Interpret your data coming from the patient, coming from the ventilator, and try to adjust your setting all the time according to the response of the patient and according to the calculated and measured data. We will start with the first scenario. In this first scenario, there is a mother brought her 6-year-old son to the emergency department. The son, this boy, complaining of fever, cough, and headache. The mother told that fever started 4 days back, not responding to antibiotic. Then a productive cough started after 2 days, which become more irritating with shortness of breath. There is the other history was irrelevant, apart from that the boy attended a family wedding 10 days ago. On examination, the baby or the child was irritable, has frequent irritating cough, feverish, tachycardic, and tachypneic, was desaturating, the oxygen was 88 on room air, where his weight was 20 kilogram. On auscultation, you found that there is decreased air entry and chest fine crackles, mainly on the left side. with no galloping. So for this child, what's your impression about this child type? So it is, we suspected that this child has a lung pneumonia, but with possibility of COVID-19 infection. Please take care. Today's or nowadays we are in the era of COVID-19 infection. The presenting symptoms are very characteristic for COVID-19 infection, coming also with suspicion of lower respiratory tract infection. So please don't miss the common symptoms of COVID-19. One of the common symptoms for COVID or clinical presentation is the fever and cough. Fever and cough can come with about 80% of patients, even if this patient, adult or pediatric, can come in up to 90% of patients. So our patient come with fever and cough, also with headache, which is one of the least common symptoms. And other than that, the patient can come with any of the rare symptoms, or there is different presentation of the COVID-19, but at least the common is common. If any patient again come with common symptoms, don't forget to suspect this patient with COVID-19. Okay, what's your appropriate initial response for this patient? You suspected this patient has lung pneumonia and suspecting that this patient has COVID-19 infection. What is your appropriate initial response? Either to order for urgent chest X-ray and prepare for admission, to put the child on oxygen mask in the ER, then prepare for admission, to isolate the child in a separate room, notify as suspected COVID-19, apply oxygen, then prepare for admission, or don't admit the child and call for transfer. Why I brought this slide in the beginning of our ventilation? We are dealing with pediatric ventilation, not with COVID. But take care, when you suspected any patient with COVID-19 infection, the first thing to do is to protect yourself, your team, and your other patient. Take care. Don't be in hurry to save the patient on the extent of yourself or your team or your patient. Suppose that you ordered for urgent chest X-ray for this patient who you are suspecting that has a COVID-19. This patient will go for the radiology department. The technician of the department of the radiology will expose to this patient. Other patient will be exposed. And after that, if this patient came positive, you are spreading the infection everywhere. Even if you put this child on oxygen mask in the emergency room, you will suspect your team and other neighboring patient to the infection. Okay? So take care, please. It is not the common scenario. The common scenario is to isolate or to screening this patient on the triage, not in the ER. Should be a room for triage to screen this patient. There is a score for COVID infection. Any patient has a higher score should be suspected and notified as has COVID-19 to protect all the team. But if you made this scenario that you have a patient, your patient in the ER with suspicion of COVID, the first thing is to separate this patient in a separate room, isolated room in the emergency room. Separate and notify for everyone or you of your team that I suspected that patient has a COVID-19. Everyone examine or dealing with this patient should wear a full PPE, a full personal protective equipment, not to be infected from the patient. Save yourself, protect your team, protect your patient, and after that, thinking to put this patient on the oxygen and to order for the urgent investigation type. After that, what is the most accurate confirmatory test for this patient regarding the COVID-19? Is it a pharyngeal swab for COVID-19 PCR, or CT chest, or blood COVID-19 PCR, plus CBC and CRB, A and B, or B and C? You should know that until now, the only accurate diagnosis for COVID-19 is the pharyngeal swab PCR, okay? Until now, if the baby not intubated, if the baby intubated, we can obtain a tracheal secretions, and the tracheal secretion is the most accurate for diagnosis for the COVID-19. But if there is no endotracheal tube, if there is no tracheal aspirate, the only, until now, accurate confirmatory test is the pharyngeal swab. A CT chest is not essential for diagnosis at all, at any time, at any time. Don't waste your time to order for CT and to send your patient to do a CT. Don't expose your patient to a heavy radiation of the CT. It is not essential for diagnosis. It is a big mistake. I noticed that a lot of doctors their concern is to do chest X-ray for the patient, even if the patient is asymptomatic, to diagnose. Why? There is no any agreement until now, any recommendation to do chest CT chest for diagnosis of COVID-19. Only send for nasopharyngeal swab. Even if the baby, you should admit the baby, no need to do CT chest, except if the baby got or get more worse and deteriorated, you know, to assess the severity or the stage of the lung disease, you can do CT chest. But even to start treatment, you need to do a CT chest for the patient. As we know, also the blood COVID is not accurate. So only number A, the pharyngeal swab, is the one I was concerned with it. The X-ray for this patient showed this bilateral and subpleural infiltration. The classic picture for the COVID pneumonia is bilateral subpleural opaque shadows, like ground glass appearance, shadows subpleural, bilateral and symmetrical. But it's not all the time it will be the classic picture. I can found any picture of pneumonia, any picture of bronchopneumonia or lobar pneumonia for the patient with COVID, but the clinical symptom is more and more important with the presence of pneumonia. So we will complete our scenario. We isolated already. We isolated the patient. We send for nasopharyngeal swab and the chest X-ray done. We put the patient on nasal cannula for liters, FT 40%. After 6 hours, the child get more distress with FI2 reached up to 70%. So we transferred the patient to the BICU where he is connected to bubble TBAB with BIP6. So on the end of the second day, the test for COVID-19 came positive. Test came positive. The child become more grunting, got more grunting and become more agitated on the bubble CBAB6. While FI2 also reaching 80% to achieve a saturation of 90%. So now we are dealing with a COVID-19 pneumonia. And until now, until this point, what is your next step for management for this patient? This patient, as we said, now grunting, agitated on CBAB, FI2 reaching 80% to maintain saturation of 90. What can I do next for this patient? Is to increase the BIP of CBAB to 8, shift to non-invasive BIPAP, do chest X-ray, or intubate and connect to mechanical ventilation. Choose number D, to intubate and connect to mechanical ventilation, which is right. But why not to increase the BIP of CBAB or to shift to non-invasive BIPAP? This patient may benefit actually from the non-invasive ventilation, may be improved with non-invasive ventilation. But remember, we are dealing with COVID-19 pneumonia. It is not a simple viral or bacterial pneumonia. It is a COVID-19. The recommendation for dealing with the COVID-19 pneumonia is to accelerate the ventilation, the invasive ventilation of the patient, and to minimize as much as you can the use of non-invasive ventilation. Why? Again, not to spread the infection for the other patient or for the medical team. This patient got more worse, more distress, agitated, grunting. Class, enough. No need to put the patient more on non-invasive. The patient will cough all the time, will need suction, will need the manipulation, will need chest care. All of this will spread the infection. Please save your patient, save your team. And the recommendation comes from the WHO now is to accelerate the intubation of the patient. So rapidly intubate this patient, please. But take care with intubation of a COVID-19 patient. Take care. There is some important thing for intubation. As first, do rapid sequence intubation. This is the least time should be done for the intubation. The most skilled one who will do the intubation there is no time for trial, because all doctor or every doctor who will try will expose. So take care, keep the smallest number of the medical team inside the beside the patient or inside the BICU, inside the unit. Only the one who will intubate, the most skilled one, and one nurse only can maintain beside the patient. No need for other one to be inside or beside the patient. If you have glidescope, you should use the glidescope. All these parameters to minimize the risk of transmission of the disease. If you use the glidescope, you will look all the time to the screen, not to the airway of the patient. So you will avoid the coughing and the reflexes of the and the spreading of the secretion from the patient. And before all of this, you should, as we know, wear your full PPE, personal protective equipment, N95 gown, glasses, and head cover, everything before intubation. Intubation is very hazardous for spreading of the infection. Okay, after intubation, your RT, respiratory therapist, calibrated the ventilator and ask you about the initial setting of the ventilation. As we said before, we'll repeat again. You should, when you prepare for ventilation for every patient, you should ask yourself four questions. You should ask in your brain four questions and prepare the answer for this question before or to know how to start the ventilation. The first question, what is the change happened in the lung pathophysiology and the lung mechanics in this patient and in this pathology? What is the appropriate mode of ventilation I should start with? What is the appropriate initial setting I should start with? And what our target oxygenation and the target ventilation? So when we start with the change in the lung pathophysiology and lung mechanics, as we said, we are dealing with COVID-19 pneumonia. This disease either is obstructive or restrictive lung disease. This restrictive lung disease means that affecting the lung parenchyma. How it is affecting the lung parenchyma? There is inflammation, there is some consolidation, there is exudation and inflammation in the interstitial space. There is some edema, inflammatory mediators, inflammatory cells in the interstitial spaces, leading to slight collapse of the alveoli and the terminal airway. Okay, there is some areas of mild or moderate collapse. And also there is exudate and there is accumulation of some proteins and exudate inside the alveoli, so leading to consolidation. There is some areas of consolidation, some areas of lung collapse. Okay, it is a heterogeneous lung disease. The net result of these changes, it will affect mainly the functional residual capacity of the lung. Lung become more atelectatic, become more collapsed, lung volume is decreased. So the functional, if you remember from the physiology, the functional residual capacity will be less. If the functional residual capacity affected, the patient become deoxygenated. It will lead to decrease of the oxygenation of the patient because the ventilation perfusion matching, it will be affected. So the main problem of this patient is problem of oxygenation. Other than that, the compliance of the lung will be poor compliance. So we know now that there is a change in the lung pathophysiology leading to decreased compliance and affecting the oxygenation of the patient. Okay, what is the appropriate mode to start with for this patient? First of all, I should choose, I will deal with volume controlled mode or pressure controlled mode or dual mode. Dual mode is like BRVC or volume guarantee. So it is better for this restrictive lung diseases. For children, it's better to use the pressure controlled mode. But the most ideal one is the BRVC mode or the what's called the volume targeted mode. Why? Because we are take the benefits of two of both modes. I will use the pressure controlled mode with flow deceleration of the flow deceleration better. And also I will target the tidal volume, so I will prevent this lung from volume trauma. Assist control or SIMV pressure support, there is, until now, there is no any data supporting either the assist control SIMV. We are depending mainly on our practice and our experience. If you are familiar with AC, it is better. If you are familiar with SIMV, you can use it, but please use with BSV with SIMV. So I will, for this patient, I can use BRVC with AC or BRVC with SIMV. Okay, the BRVC mode, I can put on the SIMV or I can put on the assist control. Okay, clear? Okay, what is the setting for this patient? Now, I remember the four questions. I know the lung pathophysiology and change in lung mechanics. After that, I choose our mode of ventilation. And the third question, I will start to put the initial setting of ventilation. We'll put together the setting. As we said, we'll start with the pressure first. What is the appropriate beep for this patient? The appropriate beep for this patient, we can start with in the middle way, not the high beep or low beep, middle beep, 5 to 6, may be appropriate for this patient. As we said, we need the beep to be the higher side to augment or optimize the function residual capacity. And if the oxygenation is impaired, the most important thing to dealing with is the beep. So beep, maybe start with 5 or 6. Tidal volume, I need the normal tidal volume for this patient, 6 to 8 mL/kg. Okay, BIB, I need the normal BIB, which is 12 to 16. But remember that, take care, this BIB is above the beep. So the peak pressure, it will be this plus this. This is a different pressure. So I will put, if I am dealing with BIB, peak inspiratory pressure, I will put 19 or 22. Okay, so the difference, it should be 12 to 16. Regarding the times, in inspiratory time, I need below the normal physiology for this patient. The normal physiology is 0.6 to 0.7. I can start with 0.5 because, as we said, there's a problem in compliance. So the compliance, the time constant will be short, slightly short. So I can put the physiological or the smaller than the physiological time constant. LI ratio, the physiological one, or even I can use more than that, can use 1 to 2. A rate, I can put a higher rate, up to 30. 30 is high for this patient, but I can put 30 because there is no need for longer inspiratory expiratory time. Okay, FI2. I am fighting all the time to keep the FI2 less than 50. You can start with 60. 60, it is the upper limit of higher to the lower limit of higher toxicity for the FI2. Yani, I am, if this patient hasn't no very bad lung, you can start with 60. No need to start with 100 because you will take time to reduce this 100 to the normal range. Start with 60 in the middle and try to keep all the time in FI2 less than 50 to be more safer for the lung, to be away from the oxygen toxicity. Regarding the trigger, the normal trigger for this age group is if we are using flow triggering, it is 0.8 to 1.5 liter per minute. So it is the flow triggering. So it is the initial setting for this patient. I try to put this initial setting, but take care, is this setting is appropriate for the patient or not? I don't know. Anyone cannot know, okay? Even if this written in books, written in the literature, but you can put this setting on the patient become not comfortable, not well ventilated. So after you putting the initial setting, you should stabilize your patient, stay beside your patient. You should observe the response of the patient. Is the patient now become comfortable, become well synchronized with the ventilator or not? This patient, there is good chest rise, saturation is okay, improved, blood gases is improved, is good blood gases. What is the measured and the calculated values from the ventilator? You should interpret all the data coming from the patient and coming from the ventilator. And according to this data, you will decide, is it appropriate setting or not? You should adjust setting or not. Yani, for example, if the patient still has desaturation, oxygenation is still low, and FI2 is increasing, you should adjust the beep. You can increase the beep gradually, and you will see you can increase the pressure you are giving because the tidal volume is not achieved. If the you will look to the flow curve and you will adjust this, the inspiratory and expiratory time from the flow curve. Okay, so according to the data, you will adjust the setting. And after that, also take care from the effect of the cardiovascular system, effect on the heart. When you increasing the pressure, you can transmit this pressure to the heart. But keep in your consideration that the most, the more the compliant lung, the more pressure will be transmitted to the heart. The less lung is compliant, or the less compliant lung, the less pressure will be transmitted to the heart. For example, if you are ventilated a normal lung, at least 50% of this pressure will be transmitted to the heart. But if you are ventilating a stiff lung, poorly compliant lung, only 5 or 10% maximum will be transferred to the heart. So don't worry if you are ventilating a less compliant lung, and take care if you are ventilated a good compliant lung. And after that, after you stabilizing your patient, you will start to wean. The parameter you will start with in weaning is the FiO2. And also the FiO2 will give you an indicator about the setting and about the lung pathology. If you success to decrease the FiO2 to the good range, less than 50, 40, or 30, you success to adjust your setting and to maximize and augment your ventilation for this patient. But all the time, if you still needing high FiO2, you should review yourself. Either your setting is not optimized, or either the lung pathology is progressively deteriorating the patient. All the time, keep your eye on the FiO2, and when you start to wean, start with the FiO2 and then look at the other parameters. So we finished the first key scenario. We bought the setting, choose the mood, and we know the target, our target saturation and ventilation for the patient. It should be the normal target range. Thank you, trigger. Trigger, we are using the flow trigger, as we said, any according to the age group. If we are dealing with infant and neonate, you can start the flow triggering from 0.3 to 0.6 or 0.7. The less number of the trigger, the more sensitive the machine. Okay, so if the baby is a small baby, a small weight, small age group, so you need to make the ventilator much sensitive for the respiratory effort of the patient. And if the patient is good weight, is an older patient, you can increase the trigger to decrease the sensitivity. For the children from 1 to 6, you can start, as we said, from 0.8 to 1 or 1.5, according. The ideal is the least number without auto-triggering. Why pressure control? Why pressure control? Again, we found that the restrictive lung diseases for pediatrics, it is more suitable to use the pressure controlled moods rather than the volume control. Because in the pressure controlled, we are using what is called a flow decelerating butter. Flow decelerating butter giving at first high flow for the patient, so will prevent flow starvation and will augment the tidal volume and will augment the improve the oxygenation better for this patient with restrictive lung disease. Okay, we can use volume controlled, but with flow decelerating better. There is option keda with the volume controlled with flow decelerating better, but it's better with the pressure control. COVID, best sedation in COVID lung. You can use, there is no specific sedation. You can use anything. You can use morphine, you can use fentanyl. You can use sedatives and analgesic at the same time. Respiratory time and time constant. Inspiratory time, as we said, every age group has a specific inspiratory time. Any book, you will find the there is parameters for physiological parameters for each age group. Okay, flow all. Most of the ventilators now, you are not allowed to adjust the flow. Flow is automatically adjusted from the ventilator. Some old machine until now, you can adjust the flow. If you will adjusting the flow, the normal flow for this age group, school and preschool children from 8 to 10, and also can increase to 12 according to the size of the endotracheal tube. You can use ketamine, yes. Maximum BIB in pediatric agent. Usually try not to exceed 25 or 30 pressure for the patient for pediatric patient. Muscle relaxant, contraindicated. If the patient has not severe lung pathology, no need to do to give muscle relaxant. For this patient especially, and it is the recommendation now for every ventilated patient not to use the muscle relaxant. Muscle relaxant will prolong the time on mechanical ventilation, will give time for more ventilator lung injury, for more pneumonia, and to make muscle weakness, and will delay the weaning and delay the extubation from mechanical ventilation. Better, there is a specific situation to give the patient muscle relaxant. Other than that, don't give. You can give even small or very minimal sedation and analgesic like morphia or fentanyl, or maybe ketamine. Okay. Type. The second case scenario, already the primary, the first patient, our patient still, we are with our patient. This patient, we intubated already, this patient with COVID-19 pneumonia. But in the first day of admission, the patient still needing an intubation. We intubated on BCEC mode. Oxygen saturation now 94 with FiO2 40%. BIP 6, BIP 14 over 6. Sedated with fentanyl 2 mic and taking spontaneous breath on backup rate of 30. But on the seventh day of admission, the baby get more worse, become uncomfortable on this mood. There is increased work of breathing, frequent desaturation, tachycardia. There is diminished air entry bilateral with fine crackles all over the chest, but he is still hemodynamically stable, well perfused with good urine output. We increased fentanyl to 3 mic per kg per hour. We increased the BIP to 7, the BIP to 18. Now the mean airway pressure on the ventilator is 12. The FiO2 also increased to 60 to keep saturation 92. The blood gas showed some metabolic and respiratory acidosis, and you ordered for urgent chest X-ray and echo. For this patient, what's your impression? This is the X-ray. We found that the X-ray has bilateral chest infiltration of all or most of the lung tissue. There is bilateral lung infiltration for both lung tissues, usually or mostly involving all lung tissues bilateral. We did echo. Echo showed normal left systolic and diastolic function, and also pulmonary pressure was normal and right atrium pressure normal. So what's your impression for this patient now? What's your professional diagnosis? Okay, ARDS, echo check, right atrial pressure. Yes, right atrial pressure was okay. Okay, thank you, excellent. Non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, what is called ARDS. So, thank you. Now, this patient got or developed ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. How we know the patient become more worse? There is bilateral lung infiltration and the patient deteriorated more and more. How can we classify the severity of this patient? There is some parameters to classify the severity of the ARDS, either mild or moderate or severe. And there is, as you know, there is some or little difference between the pediatric and the adult ARDS classification. In the pediatric classification now, we are depending mainly on the oxygen saturation and oxygenation index and oxygen saturation index, more than the BF ratio or SF ratio. Yani, we willn't go details in this area, but according to the severity, we assessed if we calculated from the from our baby or our child, you will find that the oxygenation index is 8, oxygenation saturation index is 7.8. Why we are using oxygen saturation index? If we haven't arterial line for this patient, we cannot get ABG, arterial blood gas, to assess the arterial BO2, okay? We cannot assess the oxygen index. Oxygen index needing arterial oxygen pressure. But if with this patient has no arterial line or no ABG, I can use the oxygenation saturation index. The more the oxygenation or oxygen saturation index the more worse of the patient. So if this number is increasing, that means that the patient is get more worse. 8, it is the beginning of the moderate ARDS, okay? As we know, more than 16 patients may need high frequency, more than 20 or 30 can need, or up to 40 need ECMO, and the mortality will be high. The BF ratio and SF ratio, it is mainly used now in adult ARDS, but the less the number, the more severe the disease. As we know, if the BF ratio from less than 300 is mild, from 2 to 200 to 30, from 200 to 100 is moderate, and less than 100 is severe. So our patient has a moderate ERDS, and SF ratio, again, we can use it if we don't have ABG. Okay, so we classify our patients that have moderate ERDS. Okay. Now we are dealing with COVID complicated with ERDS. What is your appropriate response for this patient? Either to shift to BiPAP, invasive BiPAP with BSV mode, or increase BiPAP by stepwise approach, or do lung recruitment maneuver, or shift to high frequency, or order for urgent CT chest? This question is not a benign question. It is a very complex question. How to choose the appropriate response or appropriate ventilatory setting for this patient. It is not easy, but to answer this question, actually, we should know what is the pathology happened in the ERDS. Okay, it is very important to answer this question to know, as we said, what is the change happened, what is the pathophysiological change in the ERDS first. The ERDS, as we know, it is a restrictive lung disease, not obstructive. What is the meaning of restrictive? It is affecting the lung parenchyma. It is marked severe bilateral lung infiltrates affecting most of the lung tissues. Okay, it is inflammatory and also heterogeneous in character. Heterogeneous, not homogeneous, not affecting all the lung tissue at the same time and same extent. Taking some lung tissue to be affected. The physiological, pathophysiological changes, there is three characteristic changes happened in this lung, in the ERDS lung. Firstly, there is increased capillary permeability, capillary leak syndrome, what's called capillary leak syndrome. The inflammatory cascade and inflammatory response leading to the increased capillary permeability, increased the interstitial edema. So it is a sore, one of you said that is a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, yes. There is interstitial edema. This interstitial edema will lead to collapse of the alveoli and the terminal airways. Okay, so an edema will lead to alveolar collapse. Other than that, secondly, there is surfactant inactivation. The inflammatory cascade in the ERDS will inactivate the surfactant, make it the, lead to dysfunction of the surfactant. So again, the alveoli will be collapsed. The third thing happened, that the alveoli itself will be occupied by the exudate, the inflammatory mediators, the proteins, the all inflammatory mediators will be occupying this alveoli, leading to alveolar consolidation. There is areas of consolidation. So the net result of these three pathophysiological changes, either alveolar collapse or alveolar consolidation. And finally, this will lead to much or severe decrease or loss of the functional residual capacity. Lung will be become atelectatic, will be small lung volume. Okay, most of the lung either collapsed or has a consolidation. So with loss of the functional residual capacity, the oxygenation will be affected. The most important parameter or determinant factor of the oxygenation is the functional residual capacity, as we discussed with the physiology. So if we lost the functional residual capacity, the ventilation perfusion ratio will be decreased. And what is the meaning of that? That the blood will enter the lung and get out without oxygenation, because most of the areas has no air, collapsed or atelectatic or has a consolidation. So blood enter and came out from the lung without oxygenation. What is called? It is intrapulmonary right to left shunt. So it says in severe case will lead to severe affecting or severe deoxygenation of this patient. So we know now that because of the loss of the functional residual capacity, the oxygenation will be affected, ventilation perfusion mismatching happen, and also the lung compliance will be affected. The lung will be poorly compliant. What is the meaning of that? That I need a higher pressure to inflate this lung. It's very important. The ventilation of this lung will be very difficult because I need a higher pressure to open this poorly compliant lung. If we look at the CT of this patient, the CT lung or CT chest of this patient, we'll found that there is three characteristic regions of the lung. You can see with me, this is the CT chest, this is the lung. The lung has three different regions here. This region, the lung is consolidated. It is ground glass appearance here. Lung is already consolidation. There is consolidation of this part, of this region of the lung. And this region is poorly compliant, and also it is cannot be reopened again by ventilation. I cannot reopen, I cannot recruit this part by mechanical ventilation. Type. On the other side, on the opposite side, there is normal lung tissue. This lung still, there is some part of normal lung tissue, the black one. This normal lung tissue. This normal lung tissue, if I give a higher tidal volume or even normal tidal volume, this all tidal volume will go to this area of the lung. So it will be exposed to over-distension, even to the volutroma and maybe leading to ruptures of this alveoli. And here there is the third regions in the lung. These regions with lung collapse, not consolidation, not normal, it is lung collapse. And this area can be reopened again, can be recruited again by the mechanical ventilation. And this area is called the recruitable area of the lung in ERDS. So in ERDS, there is three different heterogeneous parts of the lung. It is a part with poor recruitable tissue. Okay, I cannot recruit it. I cannot reopen it again. Normal lung tissue and area of recruitable tissue. So our target of ventilation is to recruit or to reopen this area of collapse again. So the trick here, how to recruit or reopen this area without overinflation of the normal lung tissue. Our protective lung strategy is to do this, to recruit the collapsed area without overdistension of the normal lung tissue. But what is happened actually in the real situation, it is a big mistake. Common pitfall we are usually doing in ventilating patients with ERDS, that we are giving a higher tidal volume. All the time, we found that the patient need desaturating, increase the FiO2 to 100, still BBD setting. So we are increase the tidal volume and increase the BIP to give more tidal volume and more pressure. And actually, this tidal volume will go for which region of the lung? The normal region, the small part with normal lung tissue, leading to over-distension of this normal lung and volutroma. And the other two areas won't benefit from this higher tidal volume. But what can I do? What is called the lung protective strategy? In the lung protective strategy, first of all, I should optimize our functional residual capacity. Okay, as we said, the problem in this ERDS lung is the lung lost the functional residual capacity. I want to reopen again, recruit again the collapsed lung to build up the functional residual capacity. If I build up the functional residual capacity, I will improve the oxygenation dramatically. Okay, how to build up, how to optimize the FRC? By increasing the BIP in a stepwise approach and increase the BIP gradually. This is the trick. If I increase the BIP gradually, I can ventilate, I can recruit this area, this collapsed area, without affecting the normal lung tissue. This is called the stepwise increment of the BIP. So by manipulating my BIP on the ventilator, I can build up the functional residual capacity, I can increase it, and I can improve the oxygenation. So the concept is to open the lung and keep it open. If I open the lung, optimize the FRC, the lung will be more compliant, so I can ventilate this lung very easy. But before, it is less compliant lung and I needing a higher pressure. So optimize FRC, open the lung and keep it open. And at same times, you should use a small tidal volume. No need to use a high tidal volume. The only part will benefit from the tidal volume is the normal lung tissue. So as much as you can, use the less physiological tidal volume. This is what's called the lung protective strategy. To understand this, you should remember the BV loop, the pressure volume loop, which represents the compliance of the lung. With the lung, when the lung become was collapsed here, the compliance of the lung is very poor. I need a higher pressure to inflate the lung. Okay, but when I optimize, I increase to the functional residual capacity, I can ventilate the lung very easily because the compliance will be improved dramatically. So you can see that the curve is now is rising. Okay. So I need all the time to ventilate the lung in this area. So for our patient, I can increase the BEEP in a stepwise approach to answer our question. This baby was on BEEP 7. I can increase BEEP to 8, 9, 10. I can increase the gradually every 4 or 5 minutes until I get a normal or a good saturation. For example, if this is the saturation of the patient is 92, when I reaching the good lung volume, the saturation will be dramatically improving to 98 or 99, and the chest expansion will be improved. The expired tidal volume measured on the ventilator will be improved. So by this parameters, I will know that the BEEP now is sufficient or recruited the lung, okay? When I increase the BEEP gradually, I will optimize the functional residual capacity. How to know that the FRC is optimized or achieved? By the lung volume, by the chest expansion, by the improving in the saturation, by improving in the exhaled tidal volume from the patient. Okay, fine. What is the lung recruitment maneuver? Some of you choose the lung recruitment maneuver. The lung recruitment maneuver is the same like this situation, is to increase the BEEP gradually, okay? But if, for example, if I need to increase the BEEP for this patient, I increase up to 10, after that reaching 12, reaching 14, and the BEEP improved on after reaching 16, BEEP of 16. Okay, saturation now is okay, chest expansion. I can decrease the FI2. But still the patient on higher pressure. This pressure is not safe for the patient, it's still injurious. I am afraid to keep the patient all the time on this higher beam, okay? So I can try another protocol, another approach, which is called the lung recruitment maneuver. So when I use the lung recruitment maneuver, when our beam is increasing more than 12 to achieve good oxygenation, okay? So for this patient, I can start initially with increase BEEP in a stepwise approach. If this patient improving on BEEP up to BEEP 12 is okay, but if I need more BEEP, I will lead me to use the lung recruitment maneuver. What is the lung recruitment maneuver? We'll try to simplify. The lung has a specific characters. Is called lung hysteresis. What is the lung hysteresis? Our lung is filled with air, not filled with fluids. The lung which is filled with air have special behavior during inflation and another behavior during expiration or during deflation. If the lung filled with fluid, our lung filled with fluid or saline like this. This is an example. If I filled a lung of a cat with saline, the inflation and deflation limb of the curve will be identical, will be the same behavior. But here, during lung inflation, there is a specific behavior. But during lung deflation, there is another specific behavior, not the same. The lung on the deflation limb, when become deflating the air, will keep the volume on a lesser pressure. In another word, the lung can keep the volume during deflation with lesser pressure. The volume needed to keep lung open is less than the pressure needed to the keep lung open is less than the pressure needed to open this lung. Look at this loop or this curve. This is the BV loop, pressure and volume, our curve here during inflation. During inflation here, if this pressure is 10, with 10 pressure during inflation, the only lung volume may be 15 only, okay? But if I inflated this lung during deflation at pressure 10, the lung still has at least 40 mil of air inside it. So this lung will keep good volume with lesser pressure during deflation. The pressure needed to keep this lung open is less than the pressure needed to inflate this lung. So when I can inflate this lung here. When I increase the BEEP during inflation, I will reach this point. And this point, the pressure will be 16, for example. And I will achieve a good chest expansion and a good saturation. But I can ventilate this lung on the deflation limb. And I will keep the same volume on a lesser pressure. This is a study done to show us what is the hysteresis, lung hysteresis, and how to do the lung recruitment. We are using a pig's lung, okay, and excised pig's lung, and we are start to inflate this lung gradually by continuous BEEP pressure. We started from zero. We started to inflate the lung. The lung collapsed at zero pressure, collapsed, increased from 0 to 4, to 8, 12. At 16, at pressure 16, the lung start to open to be good inflated. There is good lung volume now. This point of pressure is called the opening lung pressure, the pressure at which the lung become good inflated and open. When we increase to 20, the lung become over distended, over inflated. Okay, now we inflated the lung. We will start to deflate this lung again in the same sequence, in the same maneuver, okay? We will decrease the gradual. We'll decrease the BEEP from 20 to 16, okay? Decreased from 16 to 12. The lung should be collapsed, but the lung didn't collapse. Why? Because during deflation, the lung will keep the volume at a lesser pressure. So we found that when we decrease from 16 to 12, the same lung volume, when we decrease to 8, the same lung volume, okay? You remember that here at 8, the lung was collapsed. At 12, the lung was collapsed. When we decrease from 8 to 4, the lung start to be collapsed again. So this pressure is called the closing pressure of the lung on the deflation limb. The pressure, and there, under this pressure, the lung will be collapsed. So why I ventilated the lung on this, the inflation limb? We are usually doing like this. I increase the BEEP gradually till reaching this BEEP. BEEP will be adequate, and I will keep the patient here on this stage. But why not to ventilate this patient on this deflation limb? When I decrease the BEEP gradually, I can keep the same volume with less pressure. I can keep the patient on BEEP 8 with good lung volume. This is called the lung recruitment maneuver to simulate what happened in the lung because of the character which is called the lung hysteresis of the lung. So the idea here is to inflate, to ventilate our lung on the deflation limb, not on the inflation limb type. How to do this, the lung recruitment maneuver? Lung recruitment maneuver is maneuver done in about 45 to 1 hour. I will sit beside the patient. I will start, you remember our patient, the BEEP was 7. I will start to increase the BEEP gradually from 7. I will increase 2 every 4 to 5 minutes, and I will wait until the result. I increase from 7 to 9, then to 11, then to 13. At some point, I will reach the opening pressure of the lung. The lung will be open, exposed, or imagine that at 16, I reached that the lung is open. So I will document this pressure as the opening pressure of the lung, okay? And I will increase the beep above the opening pressure to 18, okay? After that, how I know that this the opening pressure of the lung, as we said before, from improving of the chest rise, from improving of the saturation, from improving of the exhaled tidal volume from the patient. When I reach this point, I will found that I will document that it is the opening pressure of the lung. Okay. After that, I will decrease the beep gradually in the same manner. I will decrease from 18, 16, 14, every 4 to 5 minutes until I reaching the closing pressure of the lung. Exposed at 8, when I decreased from 8 to 6, the saturation deteriorated again. So I will document that 8 is the closing pressure of the lung. So I documented now, opening pressure is 16 and closing pressure is 8. And after that, I will do this maneuver again, but much rapidly. I will increase the beep much more or faster to 16 to 18 above the opening pressure. And I will decrease again, not to the closing pressure, but at least 2 centimeter water above the closing pressure. We said that the closing pressure for this lung was 8, so I will keep the lung on pressure on 10. So now I achieved good saturation, good oxygenation, good lung volume with less pressure. In the first I put on 16, but now I put the patient on 10. What this is called the lung recruitment maneuver. Every day I can do the lung recruitment maneuver for the patient to assess the severity of the disease. And I will document the opening and the closing pressure, and I will leave this parameters beside the patient. And everyone disconnect, if the patient disconnect from the ventilation, I will should do this this maneuver again to recruit the lung. We increase the beep gradually, slowly. Every 4 to 5 minutes, I will increase the beep 2. يعني if we started with beep, مثلاً 6, I will increase to 8, and I will wait for 5 minutes, and I will watch the patient response and the saturation. Patient not improving, I will increase to 10. I will wait for another 5 minutes until I reaching the point that the improving of the saturation and the chest expansion. This point is called the opening pressure of the opening pressure of this lung. After that, I will decrease the beep in the same manner, very gradually, until I reaching the closing pressure. The closing pressure, the pressure at which everything deteriorated again, the saturation and the chest expansion and the tidal volume. If I am doing that, this lung recruitment maneuver with conventional ventilation, all the time keep the BIB the same. If you are using, start with BIB 12, keep all the time in BIB is 12. If you are using the difference between BIB and BIB, you are starting, for example, 20 over 6. So all the time try to keep this difference the same. So the difference for your patient is 14. So if you're increasing the BIB 2, increasing the BIB also 2 to keep the difference the same. Yes, Dr. Awala said that I can increase the BIB more and more and more and patient not improving. This is a non-recruitable lung. But I don't know if my lung is recruitable or not. Every patient with ERDS, I should try the lung recruitment. Maybe yani, in most of cases, it is a recruitable lung because we said there is areas of collapse. So it will be recruited. But at some patient, at some pathologist, it may be not recruitable. But I don't know from the start, I should try first. Okay, so regarding our patient, what is the mode of ventilation I should start with? For this patient, again, ERDS, it is a severe restrictive lung disease. It's better to put this patient on pressure control. The evidence towards the pressure controlled ventilation or volume targeted ventilation like BRVC. So either pressure controlled or BRVC. And AC or SIMV is the same, but also better to put an assisted control. So assisted BC-EC mode or EC with BRVC. Okay, clear? Time. BIPAP mood and ABRV, it is a higher supporting for this patient. If the patient is not improving after optimizing our setting, after do the BIP increase of the BIP and recruitment maneuver, I can put my patient on the BIP or ABRV mood before shifting to the high frequency. It is the last modality to use before shifting to the high frequency ventilation. So again, I will start with BCEC mode or AC with BRVC. And if the baby not improving, I can try it BIPAP or ABRV before shifting to high frequency. Type the setting, can maximum BIP for ARDS, I can reach for pediatric up to 2022. Type, we will see together. Start with BIP. BIP is very important to improve the oxygenation for this patient. We will start with a high BIP. Okay, as we said, start with BIP 8, at least BIP 8, and you can increase, as we said, in stepwise approach, can reach 12. If you need more than 12, you can do the lung recruitment maneuver. The tidal volume will use the smaller physiological tidal volume, 6, or can use less than that, because as we said, we are ventilating only small normal lung tissue. BIP, the keep all the time to keep the BIP less than 30 all the time if you are using BRVC mode or pressure control. Regarding the time, we need this poor compliant lung, the time constant will be short, so the inspiratory and expiratory time will be short. No need to give higher or longer time. So I can start with 0.5, okay? I can put the IE ratio 1:2 or even 1:1. It is accepted for this patient. And the rate, I can put on a higher rate, up to 40, okay, to support the patient well. So regarding the rate, remember the time constant is low. The FI2, again, try to keep the FI2 at least less than 60. It is very difficult for this patient. Triggers the same as we said before. Then again, remember, stabilize, adjust according the clinical situation and the saturation, target saturation ventilation. For this patient, our target ventilation, we can accept what is called permissive hypoxemia and permissive hypercapnia. I can accept saturation of 88 to 92, and I can accept CO2 up to 50 or 55 for this patient, not to give higher support for the patient, okay? Take care from the cardiovascular system, and after stabilization, start to wean. طيب نبتدي في الكيس سيناريو, third case scenario. In general, it is 5 years old girl admitted with acute asthma exacerbation. The patient is a chronic asthmatic on prophylactic fluticasone, not close adherent to medication, last 4 months. And there is family history of cigarette smoking, admitted to the hospital or the emergency department oxygen mask. We started salbutamol nebulizer, but still irritable with increased work of breathing. Saturation still on the lower side. The doctor of the ward called you from the BICU to assist this patient for possible of BICU admission. On auscultation, you found that there is decreased air entry bilateral. There is bronchi. Tachycardia with audible grunting for this patient. So it is acute asthma, 5 years old, come with acute asthma exacerbation, not responding to the initial beta 2 agonist nebulization. Well, until now, the patient is grunting. We needing a higher FI2. This is the X-ray showing hyperinflation of the lung. You decided to admission this patient in the BICU, and you started your regimen of management of the acute asthma, IV terbutaline, start solmidrol, continuous nebulizer, with close monitoring and observation of the cardiopulmonary system. Blood gases was acceptable with CO2 whoosh, but until now, the patient still grunting. There is heavy work of breathing, markedly distressed, grunting. So you decided to put patient on a higher respiratory support. The patient still was on oxygen mask, but you will upgrade your respiratory support because the patient is still grunting regarding even after you starting all management of therapy for the acute asthma. What is the appropriate choice for ventilation for this patient? Is to intubation and put on mechanical ventilation to put on nasal CPAP, non-invasive BiPAP, on non-rebreather mask. Yani, you know that there is controversy regarding this issue to using the non-invasive ventilation in the patient with acute asthma exacerbation. But we have some evidence regarding the initial starting of non-invasive ventilation. Non-invasive ventilation may be beneficial for this patient, okay? Can decrease the lung injury from mechanical ventilation. As you know, the ventilating of severe asthma is very difficult. This lung will be more and more prone for lung injury. Take care. So please try first. There is, you have some evidence to try non-invasive ventilation. Try first non-invasive ventilation. Most of the patient will in need for mechanical ventilation or will in need for intubation. So it is better to try non-invasive ventilation as CPAP. We can start with CPAP at first or BiPAP, but first start with CPAP. This patient may be improving. When to start mechanical ventilation from the start without non-invasive? If there is some characters, if the patient become silent chest, markedly distressed, there is no air entry, I can go for even after all maneuvers to open the lung, all maneuvers to bronchodilation, still silent chest, I can go for mechanical ventilation. If the patient start to be hemodynamically unstable, become hypotensive, hypoperfused, if the patient become has a disturbed conscious level, okay, alas, become drowsy, will enter in the coma, I should intubate and put on mechanical ventilation if there is cardiac or respiratory arrest. So for this patient, I will try CPAP first to get the benefits. I can prevent the intubation for this patient. But actually, after connecting to bubble CPAP, it's not improving. So this patient is shifted to non-invasive BiPAP. And after 5 hours, the girl become drowsy. On the non-invasive become drowsy. So drowsing, disturbed conscious level is one, as we said, one of the indication for mechanical ventilation. So we decided to intubate this girl, okay? Take care during intubation for asthmatic patient. Rabbit sequence, ketamine with atropine. Ketamine has a bronchodilator effect. And at some times you may need muscle paralysis for proper intubation for this, okay? Again, I will systemize, you should systemize your brain, answer these 4 questions before starting the ventilation. What is the change in the pulse physiology for this patient with acute asthma? Is it restrictive or obstructive lung disease? Obstructive lung disease. So there is airway narrowing, there is inflammation, bronchospasm, edema of the airway, of the oval, the terminal, or the lower respiratory tract. This will leading to increased resistance. So for this patient, the change in the lung mechanics, a time constant will be long. A patient needs long inspiratory and long expiratory time. What else? This narrowing will lead to lung hyperinflation. The lung will be hyperinflated because of the air trapping. All the time, the air comes, and most of the air cannot be get out from the lung during expiration. So the lung will be hyperinflated. This hyperinflated lung due to the what is called the intrinsic or O2BEEP. All the time, LBEEP is increasing. This leading to increased work of breathing and also will affecting the venous return and cardiac output. And also the physiological dead space will increase. There is a markedly hyperinflated lung or not all this air and not sharing with ventilation perfusion matching. So because of the obstruction, I will get this 3 pathophysiological changes in the lung, severe resistance, hyperinflation of the lung, and increased dead space. So when I choose my setting and my mode of ventilation, I should think about how to deal with this a change in the pathophysiology. Regarding the mode of ventilation, it is better to start with pressure or volume control. Patient with acute asthma, it is better to start with volume controlled mood, or the better and better, it is the volume targeted mood. If you have BRVC, volume guarantee, auto flow, any mood you can start with. It is better, more safer for the patient. AC or SIMV plus pressure support. The practice for dealing with this patient or the experience, there is no evidence here, little evidence, but the experience said that I need to give this patient a higher sedation. Even I can give this patient a muscle paralysis. Our target of ventilation to do two things, to do what is called the hypoventilation. Hypoventilation, the lung is hyperinflated, okay? I need to increase the volume of the lung. And because of the higher resistance, I need to prolong the inspiratory time and give a smaller and smaller rate to the patient. I cannot make this except after good sedation of this patient. I need to sedate this patient well. Even I can give a short period of muscle paralysis. So better to use the SIMV mode, because with this mode, I can control the pressure or the rate number of braces given to the patient. But in assist control, I cannot guarantee the rate this patient triggered. Again, our target is hypoventilation. So I will give good sedation, strong sedation, even muscle paralysis. I will put the patient on a smaller rate. So I will give more time during expiration for this patient to make the air to leave the lung. So again, volume controlled mode or BRVC mode with SIMV mode with pressure support. Type the setting for this patient. Type, we can start with the pressures. For the babe, remember hypo or controlled hypoventilation. I need to minimize the hyperinflated lung. I will give a small beep, so I can start with low beep. This is one of the very little situation. I am using in it a small or low, very low beep like this. So there is, until now, there is literature, there is evidence, there is practice supporting the low beep, 2 to 4. I can start with 3 or 4 at the beginning to allow the lung volume to decrease. There is some literature supporting the use of normal beep, 4 to 5. But for this patient, start with 3 or 4, and according you will handle tidal volume, the higher physiological tidal volume, 6 to 8, I will start with 8, because there is physiological decreasing. The pressure, keep all the time, this patient will need a higher pressure. Because of the hyperinflated lung, the pressure and the lung needing a higher pressure to be ventilated. So take care, your pressure not to exceeding 30. So the very significant here in the pressures is the low beep type. The time, which is the most important thing for us. I need a higher or longer inspiratory time. Long inspiratory time and longer expiratory time. So if I start with inspiratory time with 0.8 or 1, I can put the expiratory time more and more longer. So the IE ratio will be at least 1 to 3. But I need more than less than 1 to 3, 1 to 4, or even 1 to 5. So I will use, for this reason, I will use very small or little rate. Okay, you remember that now we discussed the other scenario is 30, 40, now 12 or 15 is enough for this patient. Remember, I will give good sedation, even muscle paralysis for this patient. I need this patient to be breathing at a lower rate. So for example, if I bought rate of 12, so the cycle, the respiratory cycle, it will be 5 seconds. So every 5 seconds, I will give breath. If I bought the inspiratory time 1, the expiratory time will be 4. So it is 1 to 4. Okay? So now I will put a small rate, lower rate, and I will prolong the inspiratory and expiratory time. So I will give more time for this trapped air to be get out from the lung. So I will improve the lung hypoventilation on the long term. And if I do, try to be less than 50 and trigger me need some extent higher trigger, because this patient has a higher work of breathing. So it is clear the setting here. Remember, time constant is very prolonged and we need control the hypoventilation. Remember again, the fluid status because of the hyperinflated lung, me affecting the venous return and me affecting the cardiac output. So all the time try to augment your fluid status of the patient through the, if you inserted the central line through the CVB, you can measure if this patient needing fluid to optimize, to augment the cardiac output, give, okay? And remember, sedation is very important for this patient. You can give ketamine, propofol, because they have a bronchodilator effect, and even we can use a muscle paralysis like bancronium. And after that, as we said, our target saturation is 92 to 95, and the CO2, I need the CO2 all the time in the normal range. If this baby, and even I can accept some permissive hypercapnia for this patient, okay? Now we finished already the asthma. The last, I think, is the last case scenario, inshallah. Type case scenario, that 5 months old infant admitted to the ER with marked tachypnea and tachycardia, 5 months old, has history of moderate VSD since birth with difficulty of feeding 2 days back. On examinations, there is galloping rhythm, tachycardia, bilateral chest crackles, dyspnea, moderate hepatomegaly, normal blood pressure, but there is poor skin perfusion. You admitted this patient to the BICU, put on nasal cannula, started diuretic therapy, captopril IV fluid, still has a high work of breathing with poor perfusion. What's your impression about this patient? Heart failure, there is galloping with tachycardia, tachypnea, enlarged liver, the triad, but the patient has poor perfusion, okay, until now, with high work of breathing. The lung showed is fluided with fluids. There is some sort of lung edema, lung plethora, because of the congestive heart failure, okay? You decided to put this patient on mechanical ventilation. Why? We are dealing with a heart failure, this cardiac issue. Why to ventilate this patient? Why? The main indication for this patient is to minimize, elevate the work of breathing. The main indication for ventilation of this patient with acute congestive heart failure to elevate work of breathing. Why? And we said before in the previous sessions, during high work of breathing, we can consume up to 50% of our oxygen consumption, up to 50% of our cardiac output. You can imagine, during the normal situation, we only consume up to 5 or even 7% of our oxygen requirement, of our oxygen content of the body and our cardiac output. But with increased work of breathing, we can consume up to 50, even 60%. 60% of this oxygen content of this patient will go only for the respiratory muscles. Most of half of the cardiac output will be only for the respiratory muscles, and all other body, all other vital organs will benefit only from the other 50 or 40%. So I will, by this work of breathing, the heart failure, low cardiac output will be aggravated, will be exaggerated. So the patient will be all the time poor perfused. Only 40%, there is defect in the oxygen delivery. There is defect in the cardiac output until now. So when I decrease this work of breathing, I can preserve the oxygen for the vital organs, for the other body. So we consider that the mechanical ventilation is a good inotropes. If anyone working the BICU with, if handling with patient with heart failure, with increased work of breathing, when we are putting this patient on the mechanical ventilation, the patient is dramatically improving. The patient become perfusion will be improved dramatically. Why? Because we are supporting the patient. We are decreasing the work of breathing. So again, a mechanical ventilator is a good inotropes. Why? Because it will elevate the work of breathing, okay? But one doctor will say, type, what's the effect of the heart? Yes, we can affect the heart. We can decrease the venous return, but to a lesser extent, if we did good ventilation, we won't affect the heart. Even, the positive pressure ventilation, it augments the left ventricular output. It augments the left ventricular function. I know that the relation between mechanical ventilation and the cardiopulmonary response is very complex and very difficult to explain now, but at least you should know that not the positive ventilation is not harmful all the time for the patient. So when I intubated this patient, I started to put the initial setting of the mechanical ventilation, but I should ask me the four question: what is the change in the lung both physiology and lung mechanics? It is a lung edema, so it is a homogeneous restrictive lung disease affecting the lung compliance. What is the mode of ventilation I should choose? I should choose the pressure controlled mode. Again, restrictive lung disease in small age group, it is better to use the pressure controlled or the ideal, the volume targeted mode. And the ideal to use the assist controlled. Why? Because as we said, we know we need to elevate the work of breathing. We need to assist every breath for the patient to elevate this higher work. So the assist control is ideal. So BCEC mode or BRVCEC mode is ideal for this patient with heart failure. What is the setting? I will say rapidly the setting. This is the setting of low lung compliance. Low lung compliance. Low lung compliance needing a higher beep. I can start with 5 and increase up to 7. Okay, I need a normal tidal volume, normal BIB. My concern here on the beep, higher beep. Inspiratory and times for this patient, it will be low times because compliance low, time constant low. So inspiratory and expiratory time can be low, short. Yeah. So I can start with inspiratory time 0.4 with IA ratio 1 to 2 or 1 to 3. And I can put this patient on higher rate. This patient will not need FI to more than 30 at any time. And the trigger for this age group, the 4 months, I can start with 0.3 up to 0.5 of the flow trigger. Okay. The last case scenario, 2 minutes, inshallah. It is a case scenario with increased intracranial tension. You admitted a 12 years old boy with rotrophic accident with disturbed conscious level. Glasscomb scale is 6. 12 years. Urgent CT showed subdural hemorrhage with marked brain edema, while other examination was normal. So you started your protocol for elevating the increased intracranial tension and the brain edema, positioning at 30 degrees at the head side, started mannitol and furosemide, and you decided to intubate this patient and connect to mechanical ventilation. Why you intubated this patient with glasscomb 6? This patient, me until now, take spontaneous breaths. Why we decided to intubate this patient? Yes, because when the glasscomb scale decreased less than 8 for any patient, this patient are prone, there is disturbance or affection of the protective reflex mechanism of the lung. The coughing reflex will be inhibited, will be affected, and other protective reflex also will be inhibited. So this patient is prone to frequent aspiration and lung infection. And even this patient at any time may be hypoventilated. So it is better at glasscomb scale below 8 to intubate the patient. Your RT asking you about your initial setting of ventilation. Again, remember these 4 questions. What is the change in lung bath physiology? There is no change in lung bath physiology. It is a normal lung. Now you are ventilating normal lung. Take care. Is very difficult or not very difficult. It is a big trick when you are ventilating normal lung. Alas, normal lung, if you give more pressure, it will be transmitted to the heart. Okay, and it may be you start with normal lung and lead to lung injury because of the improper or overventilation. So, a setting, I will start with the ideal setting, very small setting for everything. For this, the setting for ventilating normal lung according to the age group, according to the teenager or the adolescent of 12 years. Beep, the normal beep, 4 is enough. Tidal volume 5 to 7, the BIB, inspiratory and expiratory time the same, a rate, backup small rate, and FI2 should be 21. Nobody ventilate normal lung and needing high FI2. Why do needing high FI2 all the time? If you needing higher FI2, suspect that you are harmful your lung. okay? And trigger for this H group, it will be flow triggering from 1.5 to 2, okay? Remember that the target, our target saturation and oxygenation, saturation will be normal. There is no role now for severe hyperventilation to improve the brain edema. No role to keep CO2 between 20 to 25, but keep the CO2 at the normal level, 35 to 40. If, remember the neuromuscular, we finished خلاص scenario, neuromuscular disorders, the problem in this diseases that there is pump failure. Yani at many times there is normal lung, but there is pump failure, secondary respiratory failure. It may be acute or chronic. Acute like Guillain-Barré, chronic like Duchenne or the spinal muscular atrophy. If you are dealing with chronic, we said this before, if we are dealing with a chronic neuromuscular disorders like spinal muscular atrophy or something like this, try not to intubate this patient. Try non-invasive ventilation, because if this patient put on the mechanical ventilation, it will be kept on ventilation for a long time, up to years. So you will occupy your bed with a patient without any benefit. So try not to ventilate, to intubate this patient with chronic neuromuscular disease. Try non-invasive. Intubate only if the patient become arrested or respiratory arrest or cardiac arrest. And if you intubated this patient, keep the patient all the time on pressure support ventilation. Rise time, يا جماعة, we didn't mention here rise time. Rise time, very simple. The time needed for the pressure to reach its maximum level. تمام؟ احنا عندنا دلوقتي مثلا ال BIP 20. فعشان نريتش 20 ده in how long time? فالrise time ده معناه I will reach very quickly ولا I will take time to reach this 20. فالrise time ده it is a part of the inspiratory time. كل ما كان الرايز تايم از لونجر ذات مينز ذات ذا بريشر ويل بي ريتشينج مور سلولي تو ذا ماكسيمم بريشر. اف ذا رايز تايم از سلو از شورت ذات مينز ذات ذا اي ويل ريتش ذا ماكسيمم بريشر فيري رابيدلي. سو فور ذا ريستريكتيف لانج ديزيز ات از بيتر تو بوت رايز تايم شورت. فور اوبستراكتيف لانج ديزيز بيتر تو بوت رايز تايم لونج. ربنا يجزيكم خير إن شاء الله. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعل هذا العمل في ميزان حسناتنا وينفعنا به إن شاء الله. لينك